verse 2, God had already sent a message to the people. I'll go ahead and read. Okay, I'm sorry, I keep looking for that. And this is what he saw and heard. The Lord's voice would roar from Zion and thunder from Jerusalem. The lush pastures of the shepherds will dry up. The grass on Mount Carmel will wither and die. The word Carmel means fertile land. This is a very lush individual place. Many farmers, agricultural endeavors were at this area, and at this time God had passed judgment because everybody was missing the point. Everybody was missing God. Everybody. And so he sent a drought. And this time, everything was drying up. This was to get the nation's attention. That even the place called Carmel, fertile land, is drying up. But nobody was listening. So God decided to interrupt everybody's happy life. God decided to interrupt everybody's comfortable life with Amos. So Amos drove from Judah into Israel. And he says, a lion has roared. God has a message. I know some of us, I've heard some folks say this, that, you know, I just wish God would just speak to me. You know, when we're talking about praying for direction or where we should go, we always say, I wish God would just make things easier if God would just come down and speak to me and tell me what he wants.
Yes.
Wouldn't that be easy?
Yes.
What if I was to tell you he already has? He already has. And some of those folks in Israel who may have said, I wish God would just come and send me a personal message, probably would regret what they asked for. Because here it is. Amos rolls up and he gathers some of these folks from Israel around. He has a message from God and he tears right in. Amos chapter 1, verse 3 through 5. This is what the Lord says. I have New Living Testament, a New Living Translation here, because it simplifies things a little bit. But some of the translations I just wanted to take notice, it says, for three transgressions and for four. So it's a saying, a Jewish saying, that it meant an indefinite number that has finally come to an end. Which is the same thing we can say about God's patience. Yes? It's an indefinite number. He is long-suffering and he is patient, and his patience lasts for centuries. Amen. I can't get past a minute on a microwave. God has great patience, but even his patience comes to an end. So we pick up here in verse 3. The people of Damascus have sinned again and again, and I will not let them go unpunished. They beat down my people in Gilead as grain is threshed with iron sledges. So I will send down fire in King Hazael's palace, and the fortresses of King Ben-Hadad will be destroyed. I will break down the gates of Damascus and slaughter the people in the valley of Aven. I will destroy the ruler of Beth-Eden, and the people of Aram will go as captives to Kir, says the Lord. God used this country of Aram, also called Syria, to judge Israel. There's an account in 1 Kings chapter 19. I don't have this for you, but if you want to go look it up. 1 Kings chapter 19. When Elijah just finished facing the prophets of Baal, and Jezebel sends him this threatening letter, so he goes and runs and hides away in the cave. Well, after that time, that pity party, God commands Elijah to go and anoint three new people. One of them was Hazael, to be king of Syria. And Israel had turned its back on God, and God was going to judge them with Syria through King Hazael. Haziel was a servant to Ben-Hadad. God is in control. He sets up whom he will set up. And he puts down who he will put down. But Haziel and the Syrians went too far. People, I've read several commentaries, and there's a little bit of disagreement in exactly what's taking place in this, where maybe there was literal torture going on with the people, the Israelites who lived in the area of Gilead, or if this was just symbolism, meaning that he treated people as if they had no value. Either way, whether it's true torture or just some symbolism to talk about it, the Syrians treated the Israelites as if they were people who had no value. It's not my intention to get into politics up here, but we see this occurring today in the world and the country, how much hate there is, one side to the other. It doesn't matter whose side, there's hate on both sides. I never thought I would see a day, and maybe it has always taken place, and it took COVID for my eyes to be opened up, but I never thought I would see the day where hospitals would reject care to people because of a different set of beliefs or what have you. But it's been going on. A writer named John Shapiro wrote an article about a woman in Oregon who had intellectual disabilities, taken to the hospital with COVID-19, and the hospital denied the ventilator she needed. Instead, a doctor, citing her low quality of life, wanted her to sign a legal form to allow the hospital to deny her care. So we can look at the world, and we're going to get to that. We're going to get to Ukraine. But here in our own country, in our own cities, we can begin to see people with differing views begin to value the other people, the opposing side, less and less and less. And that doesn't escape God's attention. It doesn't. We're all held into account. The message from God to Amos is that we all have to account to God for how we have lived, for how we have used His resources, how we have treated people who bear the image of God. I'm sure we've seen the news with the Russians going into the Ukraine. And I don't know if you guys have seen this one. It's all over the place, so perhaps you have. But there was a particular moment where there were folks trying to flee the city, to flee the violence. And there was an elderly man in a truck. And he's driving down the highway, and a Russian tank veers over so that he could purposefully drive over this civilian. Posed no threat. Was not an army member. Was actually an elderly person trying to flee the violence. Treating people as if they have no value, no worth. God sees all. And anyone who treats people as if they have no worth or value, that does not escape God's attention. God sees how nations treat other nations. We'll see that as we go. There's a common theme. There's seven nations that God has a message for. This one here is for the Syrians, who treated people as if they were nothing, as if they were objects with no value. We see this going on in the world today. And there's our bishop from, who's the overseer of Europe, the Confederation of Independent States, which includes Ukraine and Russia and Belarus and all of them in the Middle East, is calling for all of the churches to say a prayer for Ukraine and for what's taking place. I felt that this would be a good time for us to do that in the middle of this message that Amos is delivering, for us to wake up and realize that all humans bear God's image. All humans, people we disagree with, people of different religions, people with different skin color, people of different races, they bear God's image.
Yes, they do.
And they have value, and they have worth. And what is the church's response? What should it be? If we can't be there, we should be praying. We should be going into the presence of God. We should be going into His chamber and praying and lifting them up.
Yes.
So let us do that right now. If you can, stand with me. If not, you can pray from your seat. But let's take a moment to pray for those in Ukraine right now. Father God, we know that you see everything that is going on. This did not catch you by surprise, Father God. We know, dear Lord, that there are reasons of things that are going on, things that we don't know, we can't see, but we know you're there. We know you're there with the people. We know you are there with your church, Father God, and so we want to ask and pray for their protection. We want to ask and pray for providence, dear God, that you would provide them safety, that you would provide them food, that you would provide them shelter. So most of all, Father God, we ask and thank you and give you glory and praise that you have provided them with your Spirit. Without it, we can go nowhere. Without your presence, without your word, without you. So we just want you to cover them with your Spirit and protect them right now, Father God. You know all, you see all. Thwart the enemy's plans, Father God. We ask this in your precious holy name. Amen. We'll do this a couple of times so you get your cardio in for the day. We should tread on ice when we deal with people. Doesn't mean we can't disagree. Doesn't mean we can't get frustrated. Doesn't mean that we can't get angry. It doesn't mean all of that, but we need to stop just short of treating people as if they're inhuman.
That's right.
Because they bear God's image. Bear God's image. That was the message for Syria. And you can imagine, right, these are all, he's starting out with Amos, he's starting out with all of these enemies of Israel. Right, so God is starting off with a real populist message for the nation of Israel. And so he's probably, Amos is getting some gatherers here. Yes, God, judge Syria. Judge them. Yes, go get them. Sick them. Amen. And Amos is getting all kinds of amens.
Yes.
So then he turns towards Gaza, the Philistines. Verse 6 through 8, this is what the Lord says. The people of Gaza have sinned again and again. And I will not let them go unpunished. They sent whole villages into exile, selling them as slaves to Edom. So I will send down fire on the walls of Gaza, and all its fortresses will be destroyed. I will slaughter the people of Ashdod and destroy the king of Ashkelon. Then I will turn to attack Ekron, and the few Philistines still left will be killed, says the Sovereign Lord. Philistines were a little bit different than the Syrians. Whereas the Syrians were treating people as if they had no worth, they were objects. The Philistines were exploiting people for their value. What they were doing was wholesale going into villages and towns, ransacking them, capturing them, and selling them into slavery. They were into the slave trading market. That's what the Philistines were doing. Doing this to the Israelites, and they were selling them to their cousins in Edom. We'll get to Edom in a little bit. But right now, God is dealing with the Philistines. Surely, though, I was thinking, with the passage of time, right? We are more enlightened now than this time. This took place almost 3,000 years ago. Surely today we are more enlightened and we do not have slavery occurring today, or slave trapping or human trafficking today. Several sites cite the International Labor Organization. They estimate that today there are over 40 million people, men, women, and children, who are currently victims of human trafficking. Trapped into jobs or services they were deceived or forced into joining, of which they cannot leave. The Department of Justice has identified that 83% of those victims confirmed in sex human trafficking here in America are U.S. citizens. 67% of the slave labor trafficking in America are undocumented workers. Taking advantage of others for their own profit, that's the sin that God is addressing here. And we know, it's documented, that there are many companies in America today that are taking part in this. People are image bearers of God. And the mistreatment of people will not go unnoticed or unpunished by God. As such, it is important to God. How important should it be to His church? What should the church's response be to this sin that is occurring still, even yet today? There are many ways we can get involved, but the first, right? The first is to pray. As a church, we should stand and pray that humans will be set free from the bondage driven by greed and evil in our world today. If you would stand, let's pray for those who are being human trafficked today. Father God, we want to take a moment to just lift people all over the world today, dear God.
Be aware, Lord, of what's going on around us.
Who are being trafficked. Whether through sex or through word, through slaves that are going on today. Slavery is going on today, Lord.
Father, I pray that
we ask that you would free these people, that you will help them find you in this very dark moment, dear God. We pray that you will cut through the walls, cut down the walls, and reach them some way, dear God. Let your spirit be with them.
Father, I pray.
We rebuke the evil that is taking place around us every day, dear God. I pray that you help us to be more aware,
Lord, spiritually,
that these people will be on our hearts more often, dear God. That you will disturb us to action, dear God. For your kingdom to come and for your will to be done. Father, we thank you in your precious holy name. Amen. You can kind of see it as a theme, there's a pattern. We know of the hate that's going on in this country today, and I see it all too well because I watch the news channels. Should take a break sometimes from that, right? I watch all of them. I watch Fox News. I watch some of CNN and some of that. And it is, you could cut the hate with a knife. It's dripping when people are reporting it. It's easy for me to get caught up into that. You think there was a great American philosopher, we'll claim it. I think he's probably an alien, but we'll claim he's an American icon. Yoda. Who said, fear leads to anger, and anger leads to hate, and hate leads to the dark side. Right? And he's quoting scripture. We're getting roundabout way, right? He's paraphrasing. We're getting to another nation that has just fostered their anger so much that it became hatred, but you can see this occurring in our country today. And we allow ourselves to get so far, so deep to the point where we can hate someone. What did Jesus say? How can you say that you are loving me if you hate? Right? Israel sinned. Yes, yes, go get the Philistines. Yes, they sinned against us. And so then Amos turns, verse 9 through 10. This is what the Lord says. The people of Tyre have sinned again and again, and I will not let them go unpunished. They broke their treaty of brotherhood with Israel, selling whole villages as slaves to Edom. So I will send down fire on the walls of Tyre, and all its fortresses will be destroyed. The Phoenicians, the city of Tyre, is up in the north. They were seafaring people. Their economy was driven on commerce. They were, I guess, the middlemen of all transactions. They would ship the cargo. They would take the product to the customer. They were the FedEx of their days, the Phoenicians were. And so apparently what was going on is some of the Philistines were capturing these slaves, paying the Phoenicians to deliver them to Edom. And I'm sure that the Phoenicians would probably rationalize within themselves, we're not guilty of kidnapping them, I didn't do that. We're not guilty of owning slaves, we don't do that. But God is letting them know, nothing escapes his attention. So we can play this comparison game all day long, can't we? We can say, oh, I may have lied, but I didn't steal anything. When a person say, well, I may have stole something, but I didn't kill anybody. When a person say, well, I may have killed somebody, but I'm not a serial killer. We can do this all day long. We play the comparison game. But Tyre also committed another sin. During the times, the kingdoms of David and Solomon, Tyre and the Phoenicians had a good partnership with them. And then later, King Ahab married a princess from the king of Phoenicia, and that bonded them. That made them relatives. So according to God, they were in a treaty of brotherhood. And Tyre decided to betray Israel and use the people as though they were a product, cargo, to deliver to Edom to get paid. So the Lord turns and he looks at all of these people and he addresses them. You're treating people as if they have no worth. You're exploiting people for your benefit. What is it that we see when we look at other people? The Lord would hold Tyre responsible for the exploitation of people. Rudyard Kipling, in his poem, Recessional, used Tyre as a warning to the British royalty of mistreating men and women created in the image of God. He said, far called our navies melt away, on doom stand headlong, sinks the fire. Lo, all our pomp of yesterday are one with Nineveh and Tyre. Amos makes it clear that God will not turn a blind eye. We tread on thin ice when we value things more than people. It doesn't matter how much time passes, right? This is almost 3,000 years ago when Amos delivered this message. It was 3,000 years ago. You think the human heart might have progressed since then? Think of, in the last 100 years, how much money we have spent. We were talking today with Russia invading Ukraine since World War II, how much trillions of dollars we had spent in that area. How much advancements in science and medicine and technology that we have, and yet the human heart is still depraved.
Yes.
We've made no progress. I can imagine Israel's response so far. Yes, get them, get them, get them, get them. What should our response be? We can play the comparison game all day long, right? We're not Russia. We didn't invade a country. But how many times have we hated a brother? How many times have we looked at someone we disagreed with and got so angry? There's only one hope for us, and that's Jesus.
Yes, amen.
There's no peace treaty that can be signed. There's no law that we can create that will change the heart, but only His Spirit. What's the church's response? Should it be more anger? Should it be Jesus? Need if you want to come. Hate to admit this, but I have participated in some of the anger through the past couple of years. I participated in that. I watch the stuff on TV. I listen to it on the radio while I'm working. I've allowed it. Allowed this at times, that all of this junk in this world to come into my heart and into my mind, and bitterness and anger sets in. As I was studying the book of Amos, it was, I need to repent. I need to repent and come back to the Lord and have Him realign. We talked about this in our the simple life. To realign my priorities. To get back to where Christ is. To get back to where He wants me to be. Maybe you're the same. This passage of Scripture in Matthew chapter 5 that we read from the call to worship. There's a little bit more depth here when I see some of the message that God's giving us in Amos. A little bit more depth when He says, you've heard the law that says, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. See, in those days, in Jesus' days, the Pharisees actually taught that the only people you love are the ones who return that love. And that you hated your enemies. That's what they were being taught. And Jesus comes in and flips that upside down. He says, in that way you'll be acting as true children of your Father in heaven. For He gives His sunlight to both the evil and the good. And He sends rain on the just and the unjust alike. So, Jesus is saying, He sends sun on the believers and the unbelievers, and rain on the believers and the unbelievers. So how can you tell the two apart? If you love only those who love you, what reward is there for that? Even corrupt tax collectors do that much. If you are kind only to your friends, how are you different from anyone else? Even pagans do that. But you are to be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. It's not something we can do on our own.
Yes, that's true.
This isn't... We can't do this, we need the love of God.
us keep our priorities straight, because what is our goal? What is our goal? To put people down with my opinion or my view? That's the goal of Facebook and Twitter, and what, that's the purpose for that. What is our goal as His church, as His light? To love people. Everyone, pray for them, because nothing's going to change someone more than Jesus. I can have some great speech, I can have some great object lesson, I can do whatever I want, but the power is not in me, it is in Jesus, it is in His Spirit. We'll have a moment here where we'll come to pray. We do a little bit of examining of our hearts. Let's align ourselves a little bit more where He wants us to be. If I'm not there, I need to get there. Let's reach out to Him. Altars are open. It's easy to live a life of loving those who love you. Almost anybody can do that.
Yes.
Jesus has challenged us to do what no others can. On His power, on His strength. Your light. We thank You and give You all the praise in Your precious name.